thing we normally do.
Good morning, everyone, and welcome to Hatfield Congregational. Today is Children's Sunday, so we have a special welcome for all of the young people and the young teenagers that are with us today. And also today is going to be our church family picnic, and so some people are already working out back. Tables have been set up, the grill is ready, the chef is ready, so we're ready to go with our church family picnic, which will be directly after service this morning, so I hope we can stay around. It looks like the weather is going to cooperate. The flowers here in the sanctuary are from Becky Lauren, right there, and they're in memory of her mother, Hazel. So we thank her for the donation of the flowers. So if anyone would like to purchase gift cards for Stop and Shop with Big Y, Linda is going to be coming, and she will be able to help you with that. That earns the church 5% on every sale. And also, Mary McCarthy is accepting donations for the Relay for Life, and that takes place this Friday and Saturday. Also, the hunger does not take us. Hey, we didn't move on our, we forgot to bring out our pool. We'll have to try and do that a little bit later. The hunger does not take the summer off food drive that continues today. And there is a little wagon in the back. You can drop your food donations off there. Any non-perishable food item to the church or any monetary donation is accepted, and that will benefit the Hampshire County Survival Center. And as I mentioned, there is both Children's Sunday and Church Family Picnic. Our Bible study group meets tomorrow from 7 until 8 o'clock in the parlor. The Board of Trustees will meet on Wednesday at 7 p.m. On Thursday, any volunteers are welcome to join some others from the church as we go over to the Western Mass Food Bank from 1 until 4 to help with that worthy service. At 6 p.m. that same night, I'll attend a heads-up meeting right here in Hatfield over at the Volunteer Fire Department. On Friday and Saturday, Amy Novak and myself, we will be attending the Tri-Conference Annual Meeting of Massachusetts, Connecticut, and the Rhode Island Conferences. That will be held down in Springfield, so we'll be gone for a couple days. Later on, we'll say a couple of prayers for that. And volunteers are needed for a work party at 9 a.m. this Saturday to clear out all of the items in the kitchen, because that floor is going to be cleaned. And so we've got to get all of that stuff out of the kitchen and into the hall or the parlor or something, but that's going to be a big job. If you can help with that Saturday at 9 a.m., that would be greatly appreciated. Now, are there any other announcements from the congregation?
Hello, everybody! I'm Linda. What's your name? And I'm here for the Relay of Life. This weekend is our kickoff. Mary and I, 24 hours from Friday at 3 o'clock. I will be speaking for the Hampshire County Relay for Life District. I was nominated, and so I have a 5-page speech I'll be speaking. So please come on down. Just say you're with the Relay for Life. You get in free if you say that, because there's other stuff going on. They're set up with tents and games and dunk tanks and hot dogs and hamburgers. It's like a big fair, and it's a lot of fun to be outside. So I'm walking for Sue, I'm walking for Jean. I saw Sue yesterday, she's doing very good. Jean is here. So we're gonna beat this cancer. We're gonna kick its butt, right? So on the other note, we have our church picnic out back, so please everybody come with a hot dog, hamburgers, kielbasa, chicken. You name it, we got it almost. So after church, just come on out back in the backyard, okay?
Well, Linda, don't you want to tell them why you're dressed like that?
Our team is Mary's Moo Cows, and Lucinda Williams with the cows and the farm has been so nice to like kind of sponsor us every year. With cabbage cheese that we hand out at the Relay, blow up cows. The kids take a walk around. They love the cows. For a buck, they get to carry the cow around the truck. Tracks. And they come back, and they come back, and they come back. And there's pickles going around. Some people are dressed as pickles going around the track. It's a lot of fun. So we're here to make money. We need a cure for cancer. We need this to be done and stop.
There you go. Thank you.
We only need 22 hours more to make our goal.
I don't think I heard that.
We only need $22 more to make our goal, $2,500.
So you're $22 shy of $2,500.
Yep.
Beautiful. Okay. Are there any other announcements from the congregation? Okay. Seeing none, the prelude for this morning's worship is Draw Near to Me by E.S. Lawrence. Something And so he gave his commencement as an honor to the leadership of young people. And I'm not saying that, you know, young people have all the answers, or that, you know, older people do, or clergy do. But the fact is, when you all come together and you have young people in the mix, it reminds us that my generation, an older generation, a little bit younger generation, we're not only doing this for us. We have kids who are in the line behind us, and we have to leave them, or at least try to leave them, a better world. We shouldn't give them, take everything we can now, and then just leave them the leftovers. And so kids can kind of inspire us to think long term. And I know when I'm around kids, I'm amazed at their enthusiasm, their energy, and the fact that, you know, a lot of the things that we talk about as Christians, they kind of live that. And so, you know, when Children's Sunday, we celebrate them, but it's also important to have them around for us, because their example inspires us to remember it's not all about me, myself, and I. And we are passing on something to their generation, and let us hope that we can pass them on something that is worthwhile and that we can be honored by. So one of those things that I hope we can be honored by is Hatfield Congregational. And as we come into the presence of God, who is the reason why we are here and the one who inspires us to be the best that we can, I ask you to turn to your bulletin now for our call to worship. Gather to give thanks with your whole heart. Rejoice in Christ's love and faithfulness.
We bow down to this God's holy temple. We pour out our thanks and songs of prayers.
Jesus answers us when we call. Our Savior increases our strength of soul.
Great is the glory of our Lord. We rejoice in his steadfast love.
Wait for God and hope in his word. Open your hearts to the holy presence now in our midst.
Our ears are attentive to the voice of God. We open our lives to God's direction.
Praise be to God. Amen. We would now join together in our unison prayer. Our souls await for you, O God. Our ears are attentive to your word. We hope for a clearer understanding of your will for us.
At this time of meeting,
draw us together in unity, with a sense of direction and purpose for our church and our individual lives. Renew us within, so that nothing we face around us can undermine our faith or cause us despair. Claim us all as sisters and brothers of Jesus Christ, and help us reflect this kinship in all we do and say. Amen. Now let us lift our voices high to God and sing from the Red Hymnal number 353, Lord, I want to be a Christian.
Thank you.
Right. So if we could have our young people come forward. And also if we could have Anita Wilson, who is in charge of our Christian education program. There's Elizabeth. Sophie. No Sophie, okay. All right. So, well, it's nice to see all of you. No yawning before we start the children's sermon. No way. Nice to see all of you. Look at all the food that we brought in. We have a pool that's stuck behind there. So we'll add that into the pool a little bit later. So look at all that stuff that's coming in for all these people. That's all in your name. We're doing all that. So that's very nice. But before I start talking, because I want to see how, let's go to Anita. Anita, let's do the, let's honor our eight-year-olds, our third grade graduates, right?
Right. So every year in our church, if we have students graduating from third grade, they're moving on up in the elementary school here in Hatfield. They're going up to the top floor, and they're also mature. They're good readers. They're smart kids. So that's when we give them their own Bibles. So each Bible has a little message in it for each student. And this year, we're lucky enough to have three kids who are going from third grade into fourth grade next year. So as I call you up, I'd like to present you with your Bible, okay? Nathan Lindahl.
All right, Nathan. You don't have to look like them. You don't have to act like them. You don't have to be them. You can be different. You can be special. And that's the message I want each and every one of you to hear as well. You don't all have to be the same. You don't have to like the same things. You don't have to do the same things. You don't have to look the same. You know, maybe someday half the congregation will have a person who is a little bit more of a darker skin here. Maybe we'll have somebody here who is of Asian descent. Maybe we'll have an American Native Indian here. You know, who knows? There's a whole bunch of people moving all the time. And maybe we'll have all these different faces here. And whether you look the same or look different, whether you act the same, act different, whether you like sports, don't like sports, whether you like to dance, don't like dance, whether you love coming to church or have mom and dad force you to go to church, all those things, those different things, make you special. And all of those special things are what God loves about each one of you. He doesn't just love each of you as a group. He loves you and you and you and you and you and you, all because you're you. And all you got to do is give that back to God. So when those people came up to Samuel the judge and said, we want to be just like everybody else, Samuel, the last judge of Israel, said, no, you don't. It's better to be who you're supposed to be. So you guys go out, you be who you're supposed to be, and hopefully church and God and Christ will be a part of it, but you be who you're supposed to be. Okay? God bless, guys. Have a great Sunday school. See you at the church family picnic. 50 years of wedded bliss this past week. So congratulations, 50 years. I gotta say it. I don't know if you ever heard me say it before, but I say it. The guy, it's like 100 for your husband, because we work twice as hard at the marriages. So I always tell my wife that. I just wanted to let that be known. So we're the ones who really make these things work. Also, somebody who's only around half of that time, our music director, Anthony, just celebrated a birthday a couple days ago on June 7th, and he's 27, 28, 26 years old. 26 years old. Yeah, we have to have you sit over here with the kids one day. 26 years old. That's amazing. You that accomplished at 26. Good for you. Also, prayers for two dear ladies who are struggling with cancer back up in Deerfield. Their treatments are rough. The cancer is rough, and so I keep them in my prayers. Gene Sheehan over here, so glad that he's able to be with us today. Also battling cancer, but he is here with us today. That's wonderful. Also, Sue Gilman is not able to be with us here today, but I think you all know she was in Boston earlier this week, and part of the side effects of the cancer was something with a broken bone in her arm. That has been patched up. She's doing well with that. The next step would be to treat the cause, which is the cancer. So you know how active and important Sue is for this church. Please keep Sue in your prayers as well. Also, prayers for a very successful Tri-Conference annual meeting, which will be this weekend in Springfield, and that is about taking the Massachusetts Conference, the Connecticut Conference, and the Rhode Island Conference, and all bringing us into one conference so we may have a greater effect, and also bring down administrative costs, which I think is important to consider as well. So Amy and I will be attending that on Friday and Saturday, and please keep us in your prayers that that be a successful conference. Are there any other joys or concerns or celebrations?
Carol Benson was hospitalized this week, and my son, the father of Maya, Megan, and Maddie, is in the hospital right now.
Your son's in the hospital right
yes.
now? Okay.
Eval.
Okay, so let's hope and pray that he comes home all fixed up and better. All right, and I don't know if you wanted me to mention that, but I'm glad she did. So our prayers are for you as well, Carol, and I'm so glad that you can be with us today.
Yes.
Prayers of thanks for my sister has lung cancer and she had a really, really good response to the first round of chemo and radiation. All the tumors were gone. And she's going, has to go through continued chemo, so just prayers for that, Julie.
And she's the one taking care of your mother, right?
Taking care of my mom and my dad, and my mom has to go.
Yeah.
So.
Yes.
Maybe we can all stand and sing Happy Birthday
to
Anthony since he sings some
voice.
Oh,
in my gift,
well,
I'll put my knee back.
Sure. Happy birthday to you. Happy birthday.
She woke up and said to her husband, I love you, and that's the only kind of report I got. So
So please, just take about a week for them to know how to serve you.
Is he going to go? No. Yes?
My brother-in-law can't, I think it's so weird. This is people who are supposed to.
I hope we all realize that we come with an awful lot of baggage to church, and I hope that, you know, this is a place that celebrates, but it also is a place that heals. With all of these different things going on in our lives, I hope this allows you to see the bigger picture, that no matter what happens here, that a loving God is always there for us. We had a funeral yesterday for a woman who was 95 and a deeply Christian person. And we just celebrated her life, you know, because even though at 95 her earthly life is over, we have all these hopes for something more. So God is with us now, God is with us always, and so whether it be a joy, a celebration, or a concern, God is such a gift, and I hope we all realize that. Any other prayers at this time? Yes?
I actually have a joy that I was able to attend my 40th high school reunion last night, and it was so nice to get together with people that some people I haven't seen for 40 years, and it was just really nice to be able to get together and connect with friends. So thank you for friendships.
Very nice. I wish I could have been there, but I'm only 26, so I wasn't even 26. All right. So let's also take this opportunity in the midst of our public worship, just for a few moments of silence, to be with Jesus in the privacy of our own thoughts, to let him say the things that only he can say to us and only he can say to him alone. Lord Jesus, you were once asked about your own family. You responded by pointing to all of the people who were gathered around you. It is not flesh and blood that defines your family. That would be too restrictive, too small. You call all of us your brothers and your sisters. All of us matter to you. Let us keep this in mind as we share our prayers with Jesus, knowing that they are heard and that Jesus always cares. So please join together now with me in reciting the prayer that Jesus taught us, the Lord's Prayer. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread. Forgive us our debts, as we forgive our debtors. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, and the power, and the glory forever. Amen. So many of our resources are already committed to all sorts of bills and obligations. We know that. We face that every day. These are not expected to be ignored, or hardships increase terribly. But we can also confuse wants with needs. The more and more affluent we become, the more and more wants we have. When God has given us so much above and beyond our needs, we can't simply forget our thanksgiving to this God who has given us everything. We can't overlook our Christian commitment to helping those in need who have so many more needs than we do. And we also can't forget to support this His church that has so many gifts for each and every one of us. Let us give as we can and as our faith and our means allow. single day, the extraordinary ones, and most especially, the ordinary ones. Let us use these gifts for your greater good in our world, and also for us and for your people everywhere. In God's name we pray. Amen. Well, let us join together in song now, singing from the blue hymnal number 113, Jesus Loves Me.
So that we also may be like other nations and have our King may govern us and go out before us and fight our battles. Thank you.
Thanks for reading, Perry. She was reading because today is Children's Sunday. And she got one of the longest readings we've had. Did very nice job. So today's gospel is from Gospel of Mark, chapter 3, verses 20 to 35. Jesus returned to the house with them, and again the crowd assembled, making it impossible for them to get any food whatsoever. When Jesus' family heard of this, they came to take charge of Jesus, saying, "He's out of his mind." And while the scribes who arrived from Jerusalem asserted he is possessed by Beelzebul, and he expels demons with the help of the prince of demons, in summoning them, he then began to speak to them by way of examples. How can Satan expel Satan? If a kingdom is torn by civil strife, that kingdom cannot last. If a household is divided according to loyalties, that household will not survive. Similarly, if Satan has suffered mutiny in his own ranks and is torn by dissension, he cannot endure, he is finished. No one can enter a strong man's house and despoil his property unless he has first put him under restraint. Only then can he then plunder the house. I give you my word, every sin will be forgiven mankind and all the blasphemies that people utter, but whoever blasphemes against the Holy Spirit will never be forgiven. He carries the guilt of his sin without end. He spoke thus because they had said he is possessed by an unclean spirit. Now Jesus' mother and his brothers arrived, and as they stood outside, they sent word to Jesus to come out to meet them. The crowd seated around Jesus told him, "Your mother and your brothers and your sisters are all outside asking about you." And Jesus said in reply, "Who are my mother and my brothers and my sisters?" And gazing around him at those seated in the circle, he continued by saying, "You are my mother and my brothers and my sisters. Whoever does the will of God is brother and sister and mother to me." May the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable to you, O Lord, our rock and our redeemer. A couple of weekends ago, Sharon and I went over to some friend's house for dinner. And while we were sitting around before dinner just talking, the husband shared a story about when he was growing up on the North Shore, north of Boston. Now, he and his friends would spend a lot of time out on the water, and they had this small little fishing boat that they would take out and go fishing. Now, this was around Gloucester, and there were then, just as there are now, an awful lot of really big ships that come and go out of Gloucester Harbor doing the same thing as they were doing, fishing. But their little fishing boats have to be extremely careful because those big boats don't necessarily see them. So one day, he and his buddy, they're out in the harbor, and a bank of fog quickly rolls in. The two boys, sitting in their rowboat, they can't see anything. And like I said, you have to be really careful when you're out there in one of those little boats because those big boats can come right through, they can hit you, they can sink you, and they won't even know that they touched you. So the boys, knowing all this, they're more than a little bit worried. And then my friend told Sharon and I, his buddy stood up in their little rowboat, and as soon as he stood up in the little rowboat, he saw above the fog. He could see everything. The fog was thick as pea soup, but it was only a few feet high off of the water. So sitting in the boat, he couldn't see anything. But when that kid stood up, he could see everything. So today is Children's Sunday. We don't have a lot of time right now because we rightly took out time during our service to say thank you to members of our parish who give up their time and their talent for our Christian education program. We also acknowledge the young people and their families who count church as important in their lives because everything that we teach is simply erased off of their board of their memory if we don't set them an example to follow. We can teach all the beautiful lessons about Christianity, can teach all the wonderful things about church, but if we don't give them the example to follow, it's like all that message is erased and forgotten quickly. So we thank everybody who takes the time and shares their talent so that we can teach our young people and also so we can give them an example of what being a Christian is all about. But even with this shortened time, we need to remember why we celebrate Children's Sunday. Now, here in town, there's a group of volunteers, and Melody's the one who asked me to join us when I first came. It was called Heads Up, and it stands for Hatfield Embraces Acceptance and it Dismantles Stigma. It was formed because even in this small, rather affluent community, young people have a tough time. They have trouble being young people. The issues that Heads Up deals with, they're not unique to Hatfield by any means. They're everywhere. And it's not always easy to not fit in and not know where you fit in. Now, I had a good life, a good childhood, no problems. But, you know, when you feel that you're called to ministry at 8 years old, which is when these kids just got their Bibles, you try to go to elementary school and junior high and high school and feel like you're supposed to be a minister or a priest. You don't really fit in with all the other teenagers. So I know what it is to not exactly fit into the grooves where you're supposed to in high school and junior high and all that. But you know, back in my day, you dealt with that on the limited basis of when you were around these other kids. But today, because of social media, kids are barraged 24/7. You know, you mess up in front of a few people back in the day, my day, well, you messed up in front of a few people. Now you mess up, and the whole world can watch your mess up over and over and over again as it's posted and shared from one person to another. I can't even imagine how hard that has to be for kids to be on all the time, to be worried about who's watching, who's got their camera going, did I mess up, did I fit in, am I okay with everybody else? That has got to be a huge burden. Now, sometime this summer, a documentary on the life of Mr. Rogers is going to come out. It's going to be playing at the Amherst Cinema. And I'm planning to go to see it. And I have to admit that when my daughters were younger, I really couldn't watch that program for too long. It just wasn't my cup of tea. But, you know, I've always appreciated his message. And I think his message is summed up in his most famous phrase. To all of these kids, wherever they were, when they were sitting there in Mr. Rogers' neighborhood, he said, I like you just the way you are. And that's a great message for kids. I don't care if it was in the 50s, the 60s, or today. They're discovering who they are. They're not choosing who they are. These kids are discovering who they are. And beautiful comes in a whole bunch of packages. When I turn on my computer every morning, I don't even know if it's Microsoft. I don't know. I really have no idea where these pictures are coming from. But every time I turn on my computer in the morning, there's a new beautiful picture as my screensaver. Now, like I said, I don't know where they come from. But every time they come up in the little right-hand corner, it's a little button there that says, do you like this or don't you like it? And if you like it, they'll send you more like that. If you don't like it, they'll kind of stop sending it to you. But to my mind, they're all gorgeous pictures. But some of them I click I like, some of them I click I don't like, and then somebody else is doing the exact opposite. The ones I don't like, they do it. The ones I like, they don't, et cetera, et cetera. So there's all these people, all gorgeous pictures. Some of us like them and some of us don't. And beauty comes in a whole bunch of packages. And kids are beautiful in their own special ways. And they need to know this. They need to be told this. They need to be reminded about this. Because like I said, 24/7 out there, everybody's trying to make them into the same. They don't have to be the same. And we got to tell them, you don't have to be the same. They don't have to fit into the mold. They can be different. They can be beautiful. If Mr. Rogers would say, I like you just the way you are. And it was schmaltzy. And I had trouble watching it. I got bored with it. But that message is so important that he's been honored by television and the academies and all of these things. And when he died, people had wonderful things to say about him because he cared about each and every child, wherever they were, in a wheelchair, however they chose to love, however they chose to be, whatever color they were. He said, however you are, I like you just the way you are. Now, programs like Heads Up, programs like Mr. Rogers' Neighborhood, these help kids to be kids the way they're supposed to be kids. And on Children's Sunday, I want to throw church. I want to throw Hatfield Congregational into that mix. I've always believed that Jesus is the friend who is always the friend. Even when you feel like you've got nobody else, Jesus is always the friend. When I hear about troubled young people doing hurtful things to themselves and troubled things to other people as well, I just wish that they could believe too that Jesus is not some tough judge sitting up in heaven, watching everything we do, replaying it and posting it and sharing it so that everybody knows that we screwed up, that we sinned in this way or that way, and that when we get up to him, he's going to smack down that gap and he's going to be punishing us. That's not the Jesus that really comes across to me in the Gospels. That's not the Jesus that we sang about, that Jesus loves me, this I know, because the Bible tells me so. I just wish that the kids could feel and understand. I wish I could convince them. I wish every kid, I don't care if it's here or the Roman Catholic Church or any church or wherever they go for their house of worship, I wish that we could convince them that Jesus is the friend who is always a friend. Think about today's gospel. Back in Jesus' day, the family was the absolutely essential unit. Everything was based on the family. You know, when I teach the younger kids, sometimes I'll tell them that Jesus Christ is not like Randy Calvin. Jesus is not the first name. Christ is not the last name. Christ is a title that we gave to Jesus once we recognized that he is our Savior. What Jesus most likely would have been recognized as is Jesus, son of Joseph of Nazareth. So who he was defined by who and where he came from. Family was the basis of all of them. But today, we hear that Jesus' family has traveled from Nazareth down to Capernaum to bring Jesus home. They're worried about him. They say right in the Bible, the sacred text, that they think he's gone a little bit nutso. Jesus, a little bit nutso. They're afraid Jesus is going to go and get himself into trouble, either with his own people, the Jewish people, or even worse, with the Romans. And well, that's exactly what happened. He got himself in trouble with the Romans. The family was trying to save him from that. But when Jesus hears that his family has arrived, he takes that opportunity to say something unexpected and absolutely, truly, astonishingly radical. He points to all of the people who were around him, the men, the women, the children, the fishermen that he knows, the tax collector that he knows, and the people he has no idea who they are. And to all of those friends and strangers alike, Jesus points to them, looks them in the eye, and just like Jesus is here in the sanctuary, looking at each of you in the eye, and Jesus says, "You're my family. You are the ones who mean the most to me. You define who I am. Family is wonderful. You are my family." Family was protection. Family was love. Family was direction. In Joseph, he was a carpenter. It says in Mark's gospel that Jesus was a carpenter. Because remember, he's pretty long away in life when he decides to go public with his ministry. Jesus is a carpenter. The expectation that Jesus was going to get married, Jesus was going to have a child, Jesus' son would be a carpenter. But Jesus took all of those expectations, all of those blessings of family, and he transferred them to us, his Christian family. We're his followers. We're the ones that he loves like family. Family was the closest bond imaginable in Jesus' day. And Jesus says that every one of us is brother, sister, mother to me. That just blows my mind. There's nothing closer to Jesus than you or I. To me, that's Jesus lifting us up. That's Jesus getting up and telling us, stand up in our little boats. Jesus telling us that we're blinded by the fog. Well, stand up, I'll help you lift you up. And when he lifts us up, all of a sudden that fog and that confusion of youth, of adulthood, it kind of just disappears. And when Jesus lifts us up, we can see everything that we need to see. When Mr. Rogers told all those thousands and thousands of children over the years that I like you just the way you are, that was because he was an ordained minister. He learned that from Jesus. And I hope we here at Hatfield Congregational can share that same positive message with all of our young people through everything that we do for them and everything we simply do, because that is gospel, that is the word of God, that is Jesus. So again, thank you to everyone who helps with our Christian education program, with our youth programs. Thanks to the families that bring their children here, because this is important to them, and I hope it will be important to these young people also. And thanks to the kids for being a part of our Christian family. And may they always remember the words of Mr. Rogers, inspired by Jesus Christ, who said, "Let those little children come to me, let them clamor all over me, let them drool on me, let them get me dirty. It's okay, you let them little children come to me, because I like you just the way you are." In Jesus' name we pray. Amen. So, in that same spirit, before we head out this way, I hope, I'll meet you at that door if you're choosing not to stay with us, but hopefully everybody will head out this way for our church family picnic after our service this morning. But as our sending hymn, let us sing, "Go, My Children, with My Blessing," little hymnal number 431. Let us proclaim in word and deed the mighty works of God.